So the idea is to take Gita, to make Gita followers, to make 50% of the world population by 2050 Gita followers. So the vision is based on the assumption that by 2050, world population will be, well, it is not the assumption. It has been estimated that by 2050, the world will have about 10 billion population. So we've taken just 50%. We are not very greedy. So we are, the vision is to make 50% of world population, that is 5 billion, follow Gita by 2050. Now, how are we going to do that? There's some math involved here, and I would like you to take you through that math. That namaste to all the precious audience of Sangam Talks, and it's such a pleasure to come back on this channel. So yes, as you rightly mentioned, this particular war has to be a two-pronged approach. And ever since my public discourse started back in 2018, I have been asked time and again by especially Christians that instead of complaining, why don't you do something about the Hindu Dharma? So that's actually a very good point. It's not like I wasn't intending to do something in that regard, but you know, the things must happen in a phase. That's how I carried on with my divinity studies. That's how I wanted to bring in the same approach into this war also. So on the background, I have always stayed connected with the Dharma, what I need to do. So it was a kind of introspection that was going on. But even to begin studying the Hindu texts, I mean, you need to first know where you want to start. And once you know where you want to start, you need to go and find a guru. It's not something like you open the Bible and you read it early in the morning every day. It doesn't happen like that. Hindu texts are a whole different, they're at a whole different level. So, but this, I'm going to talk about the journey, how I happened to get into the act of the other prong, the act of spreading Dharma, suddenly from the act of vanquishing Dharma. So I'll take you through that journey, how it happened, and why it is necessary, why I think it is necessary. So just go online and ask the question of the World Wide Web, which is the world's oldest university, and it will reply Al-Karawiyyin, okay, in Fez, Morocco. It was originally founded as a mosque by Fatima al-Firi in 859 of the current era. And the only education that was imparted in that university was natural science, which is creationism as taught in the Quran. It was only in the 1950s that the academic subjects were introduced into this university. Now the question really is, did historians or did people or even the World Wide Web stop counting BCE as part of human history? Because if that was counted, one of these universities, this was the university I was talking about, so this is Al-Karawiyyin in Fez, Morocco, this is what the World Wide Web, the internet, shows you as the world's oldest university. Although in this university, until the 1950s, only the natural sciences were taught. And we know what natural sciences, according to Islam, are. They are, that's creationism according to the Quran. But the question that I was asking is, why did they stop counting BCE, or did they stop counting BCE as part of human history? Because if they did, one of these universities, you know, the Mithila, or, you know, the Nalanda, or Takshashila, Sharda Peet, Vallabhi. You know, you can just go on. So, in fact, the world's first 10 oldest universities would then be the ones established in ancient India, 1 to 10. Of course, these are not operational now, thanks to Fatima's race. They have been destroyed. So, and this was a place, I mean, our universities were places where real subjects were being taught, unlike natural sciences and, you know, creationism, mathematics, grammar, logic, Vedanta, I mean, you name it. So philosophy, I would say, archery, archaeology, surgery, astronomy, astrology, law. So real subjects were being taught in these universities. And people from all over the known world, the ancient world, Tibet, Greece, China, Arabia, Nepal, Persia, that was the known world. People from all these countries used to come and study in this, in these universities. And today when we hear words like Bharat Vishwaguru and, you know, Bharat was the ancient culture that taught the entire world. This is the reason it is called Vishwaguru. It is referred to as Vishwaguru. Now, when the illiterates, as I said, they're not operational today. When the illiterate Turkish Muslim plunderers burnt and destroyed all our universities, one after the other at various times in the history of their loot, the manuscripts, listen to this carefully, the manuscripts burnt for months. And this has been noted by one Persian historian called Minaj Is-Siraj when he referred to Nalanda University's destruction. Such huge was the collection of education material of Bharat. So if education was so important and there was so much material that the manuscripts burned for months, what did this guy that we know him, that we know as Macaulay, mean when he said that a single shelf of a good European library was worth the whole native literature of India and Arabia? He just means that, hey, I am jealous of India. I am jealous at the kind of material these ancients had put forth. And compare this with another statement just a few years later after Macaulay may have made that statement. There was another very famous person, Mark Twain, who was a very unbiased and a realistic observer of India. And this is what he had to say. This is indeed India, the cradle of human race, birthplace of human speech, mother of history, grandmother of legend, great-grandmother of tradition. Now contrast these two statements of Macaulay and Mark Twain. And Macaulay was purely just being nasty, jealous. And so if you actually look at our entire history, what were they trying to do, be it the Muslim invaders or especially Macaulay and his clan? It was a deliberate attempt to erase our traditional education system and replace it with English. And they began it with systematically making us feel inferior about our own systems of learning. They succeeded in it. Because today we do not have a sense of pride of our heritage. I see these comments on social media whenever the topic is about how great Indian traditional education system was. You see a bunch of people commenting that Indians or India just wants to claim everything. So it's so hard for a section of the population, Indian population, to believe that India had these advanced systems of learning. So that is what Macaulay tried to do, and he succeeded, I would say. So the Muslim invaders destroyed our temples of learning, and Macaulay and his clan destroyed our traditions of education. But the point I'm trying to make here is, how long are we going to remain in the blaming mode? So we know that these people, we know what our history says, what the invader, Muslim invaders did. We know what the Christian invaders did, colonizers did. But are we going to remain in this blaming mode forever? I think it's time for us to question, what can we do? Now, when I put that question to myself, I was faced with, I realized there's a ton of opportunity here to stop whining and to start doing something. And this was really a turning point for me. And I must really thank my Christian brothers and sisters who pointed out time and again, though not with good intentions, they just wanted to challenge me, but I took that as I took it positively, and I started thinking, what is it that I can do? So when the question of I comes, I have to tell you a little bit about my own journey. So I went from a Brahmin Hindu. Now, a lot of people objected to me calling myself Brahmin in Rajiv Malhotra's interview, but why not? So I would time and again refer to myself as a Brahmin Hindu before I got converted to Christianity. So from there, I converted to Pentecostalism. That's a denomination within Christianity. And after 25 years of devout practice of Christianity, I quit Christianity. That's the story most of you know by now. And then I was in America at this time. So anybody who quits Christianity, I think first tends to explore atheism. And that's what I did. That's the normal route that I took. So as soon as I quit Christianity, to me, there was no God, because that was the only God I knew. So I became an atheist, I would say. Although not, I didn't decide, I didn't conclude that there was no God, but there was a period which was very depressive, and I became pessimistic about even learning or embracing another worldview. So that story or that transition phase is for another day. But I was exploring, but then I would say my stance was atheism. And then from atheism, after this pain of quitting Christianity, or the pain of knowing that there may not have been a real historical Jesus, I went to being an agnostic. Maybe. We cannot tell for sure whether God exists or not. So from there, as I said, my exploration was continuing. I kept to my, thanks to my heritage, I kept the positivity alive in all of this. I got on to the practice of meditation, and to my good fortune, as soon as I became public, I happened to meet a lot of gurus, I must say, or people that were preaching and teaching Hinduism, a lot of Swamijis, Pitadipatis. So I've had the good fortune of meeting all these people in my journey. And many of them, most of these people were evolved gurus of the Gita. And from there, I started looking at Sanatan Dharma. And these gurus that I used to talk to, and I had a million questions. I don't know, although they used to encourage me saying that no question is silly, I was really being Arjuna, I must say. So they helped me shape my own understanding of the Gita. And Gita happened to me at a time when I went into this, I incorporated meditation in my life, pranayama in my life. So I was doing a little bit of, I got back to yoga actually. As a Christian also, I used to do yoga. Even though my pastor used to time and again say that yoga is satanic and you shouldn't do, to me, it was just a form of exercise. I did not actually fathom the entire extent of what yoga can do to an individual. But I used to do it as an exercise. So I was never really away from this, the core, which is Sanatana Dharma. Although I did not view it from the perspective of Dharma and Karma principles. I'll come to that in just a little bit. So when I first came across the idea that Gita helped in removing confusion and it leads to clarity of thought about life in general, I could not fathom how a book that was written some millennia ago could help a modern human being such as me in understanding life in general. But as I immersed in the study of the text, and as I began to take on the role of Arjuna of asking questions, as I said, I began to realize that the true worth of Gita lied in the fact that it can talk to any individual from any walk of life dealing with any life situation. And that line that I just said, let me repeat it. Gita can talk to any individual from any walk of life dealing with any life situation, regardless of what faith one follows. That's what I realized. That's where the true worth of Gita lied. And the sad part is it has never been made known to modern man, which is why people like me never understood its timelessness. Now, what I mean by timelessness is that Gita is a scripture that outlives time. And it is applicable to every age in the development of a human being, and most importantly, to individual of every faith. So, if you actually look at my public life, so what I just discussed was what was happening on the background. So there's also something that was happening on the foreground, and that's my public, when my public discourse started around 2018, end of 2018, I must say. So as a former Christian, I took it as my swadharma to educate the masses about the shallowness of Christianity and how it doesn't help a human being in realizing the self. And that's where the shallowness of Christianity lies. I won't talk about other theological doctrines that fail the test of logic and even the spiritual test, but I will just talk about, I will just say this, that Christianity is so shallow that it doesn't answer the most important question human beings have. That is about themselves. So it doesn't help in realizing the self. But then my dharma, I thought, does not stop there. If I'm pointing out to that which must be abandoned, I thought it is my dharma to point out to that which must be embraced. Because this also comes from the questions that I have been asked a lot of times. These questions were by those Christians that were contemplating quitting Christianity. And that's really positive because to me especially, and that's what kept me going, and that's what still motivates me. So I used to get these private messages that said, okay, you've asked us to abandon this. I'm okay abandoning it because I was having doubts myself. And you just strengthened my resolve to abandon this. But if I abandon this, what is it that I must embrace? At that point, I thought, yes, if I'm telling somebody to abandon a worldview, I also have to replace it with another. Not that just for the sake of replacement, I need to replace it. But because I know that there is something real, there is a true message out there that needs to be embraced. I thought it is my dharma to help them complete that circle of their spiritual journey. So that's where the second prong of my work comes in, which is to educate the masses about Sanatan Sanskriti, and which is a true message, and give to them to be embraced. So that is what I mean by the two-pronged approach. Vanquish Dharma, which is vanquish the truth claims, and spread Dharma, which is the universal truth. Now, I just want to explain what I am vanquishing, because this is also a reply I would like to give to a lot of people. Anytime I say Dharma, Adharma, I talk about the about Christianity, especially in terms of Adharma. So a lot of people get offended to it. Now, what is it that I'm calling Adharma in Christianity? It is the truth claims. My fight has always been against the truth claims of Christianity, on the basis of which they proselytize, they coerce, they appropriate our culture, they preach dominion theology. So my fight is on the, if you look at the broader picture, it's on the truth claims of Christianity, on the basis of which today they are able to say that only Christianity is superior. And also, most importantly, the presuppositions that they make about Sanatan Dharma. That is my fight. That is what my fight is against, not Christians. And initially, I started as pointing out to the absurdity of their theology, or the bloodiness of their history, or the spurious nature of their propagation. But I think it all boils down to just one point at this stage in my public discourse, and that is the fight against the truth claims of Christianity. So that is what I call Adharma. Claiming without even knowing the historicity of the person that is at the core of the religion, without knowing how the theological doctrines have emerged, or how they have been established, without knowing any history about these things, lay people, I say lay, I call even pastors lay, because they do not know their history. So that is the true, and they start making these truth claims on the basis of which they engage in proselytizing. So my fight is against these truth claims, and that is what I call Adharma. So that is what my fight is against. I just wanted to make that clear. So when the question of spreading Dharma comes, what is it that I'm talking about? It is spreading the universal truth. And as I said, it's my own experience. It's not that I got attached with, or I got involved with this project first, and then I went to Gita. Then I started studying Gita. It's the other way around. Because I studied Gita first, I mean, I wouldn't say studied, but because I got to the text first, I got exposed to the text first. And after seeing that, what value it can bring to the world that we are living in, and how people can benefit, just like I did, I thought this is a good project to be involved with. And being in the public view and doing what I'm doing, I got a lot of opportunities to get involved with a lot of with many projects. Like this is a Gita project, and then I've had several other opportunities of, for example, starting organizations or being part of organizations for combating conversions at one place, or starting even a YouTube channel. But somehow I never felt that calling that I felt with this Gita project. So I would say my spiritual journey has just begun, and I'm not sure how many more cycles it's going to take. But what I can say for sure is that Gita is a text that every human being must read, understand, and reflect upon. And as I said, I got immersed in this, and I met a lot of people. One of those persons who has read the Gita, the Upanishads, and to an extent, a lot of Puranas is a person called Mr. Anand Reddy. So he's a successful businessman turned spiritual seeker. In fact, maybe now in the next talk on Gita University, I would like I would bring him also, and he can talk about his own spiritual journey, which began when he was in his seventh standard. So he was a spiritual seeker. He still is a spiritual seeker, and he was already following my public discourse. And he reached out to me and he shared his passion for Gita and his vision for a university that can impart Gita wisdom to the world. So he, and then he invited me to look into the project. And by then he'd done a tremendous homework. I mean, he'd done his homework, and he put together a lot of information about how he wants he envisions this entire project. So it's the organization is called Bhagavad Gita Foundation for Vedic Studies, and Project 5 Billion. So Project 5 Billion is one of the many projects that Bhagavad Gita Foundation for Vedic Studies has come up with. So this is called Mission 5 Billion. So the idea is to take Gita, to make Gita followers, to make 50% of the world population by 2050 Gita followers. So the vision is based on the assumption that by 2050 world population will be, well, it is not the assumption, it has been estimated that by 2050 the world will have about 10 billion population. So we've taken just 50%. We are not very greedy. So we are, the vision is to make 50% of world population, that is 5 billion, follow Gita by 2050. Now, how are we going to do that? There's some math involved here, and I would like you to take you through that math. So there's a 7-step roadmap to 5 billion. In the first step, it is to produce content. So this has started since 2017. Gita University, I mean, Bhagavad Gita Foundation for Vedic Studies has been producing content. And so far we've done producing content in the sense we are making, the idea is to make about 10 styles of Gita. So the first style would be, Gita, I mean, it's a general with a Tanpura, sing along, recite along a Gita style. The second is Hindustani ragas, and the third is a fusion music style. So as I talk now, the fourth style is underway, which is going to be with Western music, African drums, and so the idea here is to present the 700 shlokas of Gita in various styles, appealing to different mindsets. People love music. I mean, very few people do not like music. So when a text like Gita is accompanied by the music that they like, so it becomes much more easier for them to get attached to it. So that is just the idea behind producing Gita in different styles. Now, the second stage, step number two, is to raise funds for Gita University. Now, why Gita University? A lot of people, I mean, we've been asked a lot of times that, why do you need a university? Why do you need a physical university, a brick and mortar university? So why can't you do it online? Well, if you want to, if you're time bound and your deadline is 2050 and you want 50% of the world population to do Gita, know Gita, follow Gita, practice it, implement it in their life, it cannot be a online method. Well, I'm not saying denigrating online methods of learning. In fact, online methods is also one of our ways to do that. But the, I mean, as I talk to you about the other steps, you will know why a brick and mortar university is important. But let me tell you this. The connect, the personal connect, the Guru Shishya Parampara, we want to bring that back. We were just talking about how India was Vishwaguru, right? So to restore Bharat to that level, to its original position, that personal connect. So part of the project, part of the vision is also to bring back the Guru Shishya Parampara. Like a guru actually sitting in front of shishyas and then giving discourse. So we thought that a brick and mortar university is very important. So we want to establish a university either in Hyderabad or in Bangalore, depending on which state government gives us the land, and we are working on that. Meanwhile, we are in the process of raising funds. Now, we are seeking 200 crores for the first phase of construction of the university. And we want 2 lakh people to come forward to make a one-time donation of rupees 10,000 or $140. Now, that amount may be a lot for many who are willing to be a part of this project but cannot afford. So for that, we have made an easy plan, which is to donate 500 rupees or $7 a month for 20 months. So the year 2022, we have dedicated it to raise funds, and we wish to go into the construction phase in 2023. And we are aiming to commence the university in 2026. Now, step number 3. What happens in this during this time, 2022 to 2026? Now, during the time that the construction is in progress, we are going to simultaneously identify about 2,000 willing and passionate people from across the globe. And to these 2,000 people, we will be imparting Gita wisdom through online methods. Because remember, now we do not have in this stage, we do not have the brick and mortar university that I was talking about. So this, the 2,000 willing and passionate people that come forward will be imparted Gita wisdom to through online methods. Then comes step 4. We are going to inaugurate the university in 25, 26, let's say 26. That too, if all the Gita lovers, supporters, trust us and support this noble cause, we will be able to commission the Gita University in the year 25-26. And the 2,000 online students will be brought into the university as its first batch of Gita students. In the university, these 2,000 students will be extensively trained by acclaimed Gita gurus from all over India. And to this, we are going to partner with all the organizations that have already shown to the world, in fact, taken the Gita to the world. Like we're going to partner with ISKCON, we're going to partner with Gita Press. And on the background, we are working on all those partnerships. Well, this, I don't want to call this a partnership because this is not a corporation. Their support, their guidance, and their blessings. So we are working on them. And we will be, some acclaimed gurus from all these organizations are going to impart extensive training to this first batch of 2,000 students. The idea is actually to certify 1,000 Gita gurus that we like to call Sadgurus. These are Gita Sadgurus. So by 2026, Gita University will present the first 1,000 certified Gita Sadgurus to the world. And that brings us to step number 5. Now, step number 5 is to establish the first 1,000 satsangs. These 1,000 certified Sadgurus that we certified in step number 4 are expected to set up self-sustaining Gita University affiliated satsangs in their respective countries. I want you to stay with me closely here. So first, we identified 2,000 gurus, 2,000 Gita lovers, Gita people passionate about becoming Gita teachers. And we delivered online education to them on Gita, philosophy, Sanatan philosophy. And then when the university is commenced, the physical university is commenced, we bring the 2,000 people into the Gita University and train them under acclaimed gurus with the intention of certifying 1,000 sadgurus, not all the 2,000. We intend to certify 1,000 Gita sadgurus who will be then sent out back to their countries to set up self-sustaining Gita University affiliated satsangs in their countries. And through these satsangs, these certified Gita sadgurus will propagate Bhagavad Gita. That is the 1,000 primary satsangs during the years 26 and 30. Now that brings me to step number 6. Step number 6 is to present 10,000 sadgurus to the world. Stay with me here again, because from 1,000 to 10,000, let's see the math. So during the course of 26 to 35, each of the 1,000 primary satsangs, remember these, the people that got certified as Gita sadgurus went out into their respective countries and they were helped to establish Gita University affiliated satsangs through which they are propagating Gita. So during 26 to 35 years, 2026 to 2035, each of the 1,000 primary satsangs will identify 50 students from their student community and send them back to Gita University campus for a 100-day intensive on Bhagavad Gita and other services that that are offered at the satsangs, like philosophy, yoga, meditation, so on. So that is 50 students from 1,000 satsangs, totaling to 50,000 students during the years 2026 and 2035. Now, at the end of the 100 days of training, Gita University will certify 10,000 willing students as sadgurus, Gita sadgurus, adding to the earlier group of Gita sadgurus. That is 10,000 newly certified Gita sadgurus will be guided to establish one satsang each in the locations suggested by Gita University. Now, these satsangs will operate in the same lines as the 1,000 primary satsangs. And when you do the math, we get one Gita teacher for every 1 million people by the year 2035. And these Gita gurus will be guiding people in their countries in the knowledge of the self. Remember the most important question, who am I? What's my purpose? So these trained Gita sadgurus will be in a position to guide people in the knowledge of the self and impart the principles of karma and dharma. So that brings me to step number 7, which is the last step. And this is influence 5 billion people by 2050. How does that happen? During the course of 2035 and 2045, each satsang is expected to certify 1 lakh people. So 10,000 satsangs certifying 1 lakh each, which totals to 1 billion people across the world. During 46 and 50, every one of the 1 billion Gita lovers and followers will be encouraged to pass on Gita wisdom to 4 more people in his or her circle. Like I said, we are not greedy. One person to just 4 more people in 5 years, 45 to 50. So 1 billion people, passing it to 4 billion people makes it 5 billion people. Mission accomplished. So this is intense math, I know. But all this is elaborately explained on the website, on our website, which is gitauniversity.in. And this seems like this is a Mahayagya, people. This is really a Mahayagya. It's not possible by just one person. So I request everyone that is passionate about restoring India's position to its original position, which is Vishwaguru, to join in this Mahayagya. And yes, India has that potential, because India was the Vishwaguru of ancient world, and it has the potential to be taken back to that level. And it's not possible by one organization, it's not possible by one individual, of course. It takes all of us as Bharatiyas, as Sanatanis, to make this possible. And I also want to say that the idea, you know, if organizations like ISKCON would not have done the work that they did in all these decades, people like Mr. Reddy or me, we would not have even dreamed of a project like this. I would also like to bring in the mention Gita Press. I don't know how many of you know about the work that Gita Press did. Gita Press is into selling books at a very, very nominal fee. You will also find the link to Gita Press on our website, gitauniversity.in. So I hope you are able to see, you understood the concept, how easily it can be given. I just want to repeat it. We are looking for 200 crores, looking for 2 lakh people who can donate, make a one-time donation of 10,000 rupees or $140. Or to break it into smaller amounts, 500 rupees, the commitment to give 500 rupees or $7 a month for 20 months. So I just would like to say that your donation means a lot to not just us, but it will mean a lot to Bharat and her heritage. And the link to donate would be gitauniversity.in/Gita_Pracharak/Kamakshi. So thank you for watching. And you can also catch us live on Facebook every weekend, I think starting March, where we will be answering questions, not just about Gita University, but also about Hindu philosophy in general. A lot of people have been asking us what credentials we have to do a project like this. And I would like to answer that in actions and not just in words. So we would like you to connect with us on Facebook Live every weekend starting March. We will make an announcement on our website and through WhatsApp groups and other mediums. So that is where we'll be answering questions about both the project and the Hindu philosophy in general. So thank you so much for watching, precious audience of Sangam Talks.
So I was listening to your plan about, you know, how you will go about training people, find the gurus and make them sadgurus and other aspects. And from my question has a couple of layers to it to understand. So I'll try my best to be clear. Sorry. So while you are trying to work with them to work for them to be gurus and sadgurus, from my minimal understanding, I was trying to understand that when we put in our all-out effort, we may plan for a certain thing to happen, but which way it will go and what will be the result is not really in our hands because of karma, which is very complex, many other multiple factors that we can see. So you know how your plan was, okay, by this time and time period, we'll do this. By that time period, we'll do that. How are you going to ensure that? And I mean this with zero disrespect, actually lots of respect. I'm not questioning you, but I'm just wondering about that.
Yes. See, the karma is, karma keeps doing its work, right? But because of karma, you don't stop trying. You do things, you plan for your future. You keep doing your dharma. Because Bhagavad Gita says that you have to keep doing your dharma, right? Your swadharma. So here we have taken it upon ourselves to, as I said, take Bharat to its old glory. And we know that we do not have to invent anything. We do not have to create any new literature or philosophy. It's there. And we have utterly failed in taking it out into the world. And at this point, we are not worried, or we have not taken into consideration the results. Because again, that's what Bhagavad Gita says. You keep doing your adharma, dharma, swadharma. So that's what we are trying to do here. The rest is in Bhagwan's hands. So whether he, the intent is there, the intent is good, as you can see. And we just wish that it goes forward. And if we are not able to do it, we are happy if anybody takes it and runs with it.
I guess I'm guessing what you're saying is that those are your goals, that in 2026, by 2035, such and such thing will be done. But you're doing that subject to, okay, we will try our best. Then whatever happens, happens. That's the plan, is it?
Frozen. Not whatever happens, happens. We will put in our best effort, not just us. As I have said, there are 2 lakh people that are putting in their effort. If the 2 lakh people that we are desiring to see become a part of this Mahayagya, all the 2 lakh people will be putting in their effort, best effort. But the result is finally in Bhagwan's hand, right? The Supreme Lord's hand. So it's not like whatever happens will happen. We intend to take this forward. We would do everything in our effort to take this forward. Like I said, we are also trying to get the blessings of the guidance of ISKCON and Gita Press and other organizations or other independent gurus also that have accomplished so much in teaching Gita, imparting Gita wisdom. So, but ultimately, as you said, the result is not in our hands.
Yeah, so it's a plan that you're making, and subject to other things that you cannot, that are outside your control, you'll be aiming for your plan. Remaining is outside your hands. That's the plan.
Isn't it the case with any plan you make?
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
thank
you. But if you have, Aditi, if you have any inputs, please, I invite you to share your feedback, your inputs. And we will definitely take that into consideration.
I share with you a lot of things that I started with studying the Bible, born into a Hindu family, started with studying the Bible because nobody taught me about Hinduism. I was reading the Bible every day, did a 7-year, you know, those courses by mail from Kerala. I did those. I did those when my father found out. I was 22. He introduced me to Gita, and that was the changing factor. And I had a question about what the Gita University, I'm really impressed. But then I'm impressed with Gita, anything to do with Gita anyway. So what is the age group that you are looking at to induct as students? What is the youngest that can go?
No age group. There is no age group.
Little
really,
children can join in.
Yes.
Because my where I'm coming from at my age, you know, we have to start young. You can't tell us, if I come in, what good is investing in me to make me a guru? Because in 3 years down the road, I'm going to be dead. That's the end of the road for me. So we start young and start cultivating. Like what I always say, we plant and we nurture the young seedlings. We don't have to worry about the trees. They can fall off on the way. Right? So that's what was the question I had for you, that at what age? Because I'm looking at it the way you are. And I've been always concerned that how do I get my grandchildren who are now 10 and 12 and in America, not a happy place to be right now, how to get them with okay. a family who's totally anti this.
I totally understand. Totally. I mean, I have a kid being raised in America. I have raised a kid in America too. It's like you said, it's not a very good place to be in. But Poonamji, you said something about age, right? Just yesterday, I have read a forwarded message by somebody, by a friend, which is about a 90-plus-year-old lady filing her nomination for elections. She's my namesake, by the way. Her name is Kamakshi too. And so she's filing a nomination at 95 for, I think, MLC or Constituent Assembly. Yes. So age is just a number, like the cliched way of saying it. And if you look at my journey too, one of the only regrets, not one of the only regret I have is of wasting 25 years of my life. I mean, I would have been somewhere today if I had started young. So I totally understand what you mean by starting young.
I have wasted 68 years. This is way more than 25.
So it's never too late. That's what I realize. That's what I keep. My gurus keep telling me. So it's never too late. Just that what you will grasp is much more faster than what you would have done if you had started maybe at 7 or 8. I'm not saying that kids are slower than adults like us. But what I'm talking about is the maturity, the philosophy that we have accumulated over the decades that we have lived on this realm. So it's really about passion at this point, I would say. And like I was telling Aditi ji, the rest is on Bhagwan. And I would also encourage the audience to go to our YouTube channel. There are about 500 plus videos, and you will find all the styles produced so far in English, Hindi, Telugu, Tamil, and Kannada. And our intention is to produce in Japanese, Korean, and Chinese. So we want to give to the world in many, many different languages, in many styles. So to show you, we have here on the website itself, we have the different styles, Gita with fusion music. And we also have a Gita radio app that you can download. And it's a 24/7 streaming radio app. So the website is pretty intense. And I would actually like you to go online and check our different, go on different tabs. And then the roadmap that I just discussed, the 7 steps. So we have it right here, like how we are going to do reach out to 5 billion people in 2 years, but in the next 28 years. So please log into gitauniversity.in and please feel free to write to us with any questions, both on the project and Hindu philosophy. And especially Hindu philosophy, we are not going to present our opinions. we are definitely going to consult the gurus that are on our panel already, and we are going to answer those questions based on their understanding of the shastras. Again, like I said, Poonamji, I told Poonamji, please write in to us with your feedback. And we are definitely trying to incorporate the ideas of audience here, because it's not any one person's project. It's not any one organization's project. It's all of us must come together.
I wonder if you know, Esther ji, there is a Sandeepani Sadhanalaya run by the Chinmaya Mission in Powai, next to IIT, where they train people in the Gita. And this is a long course. They have a place where this Sandeepani Sadhanalaya is the place in Powai, next to IIT Bombay, okay, next to the Vihar Lake. And so there for years, Swami Chimanda had set it up, I think, in the 70s or 60s.
Okay, that's a very good input. Yes.
Yes.